Hello, I'm Ali, and welcome back to our Back to the Archive series, where we've rooted through our digital files and dusted them off for your viewing pleasure. We continue sharing talks from our playARK festival that took place in Cardiff back in 2013, a festival of games, story, and play. Odette Toilette, aka Lizzie Ostrom, is a fragrance specialist, and in her talk she asks, why is olfaction overlooked as a creative starting point? And how can we have fun making narratives out of scent? We hope you enjoy the video. Let us know in the comments and give us a like. And remember to subscribe to keep up to date.
Hi everybody, really good to be here in Cardiff. My session is about reclaiming your nose. How many of you in the room like wearing perfume or aftershave? How many of you, keep your hand up if you're really into it. Okay, about two. Put your hand up if you're not really into it. And keep your hand up if you're really not into it. Okay, so basically you are coming to see me later. So what do I do? Well, with a name like Odette Toilette, I do work in fragrance. I do events about smell and about perfume. And the reason I do these is because I think that, as a sense, fragrance is absolutely fascinating. I'm not going to talk so much about the psychology of smell or the science of memory, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to be talking about this idea of scent and story. And the reason I started doing events about fragrance is because whenever I watch a fragrance advert, there are no stories and they're just full of nonsense. The best way of showing you this is first by showing you a clip from Zoolander. I'm a bit ashamed to say that I've never seen this film all the way through. I've only watched bits and bobs, which is terrible. But I'm just going to show you a clip which you might find amusing.
Moisture is the essence of wetness. And wetness is the essence of beauty.
So, yes, fragrance advertising as parodied in Zoolander is a load of baloney. I did a whole event on this subject a few months ago, and we touched on such subjects as why do so many fragrance ads for female perfumes feature glamorous women in evening gowns hanging out in a stately home in France with panthers in the grounds let loose? And what does this say about why we wear fragrance, that it's about some kind of big cat sort of fantasy? And this of late has got even more ridiculous. This is the new film for La Légende de Shalimar, Shalimar being the Guerlain fragrance from the 1920s. Now, every Christmas for the last few years, we've all got used to Chanel or Dior launching their latest Baz Luhrmann, usually featuring an A-list actress, where you have your 20-second TV ad, and then you can look online for the full version, which gives you the full story. There usually isn't a story, it's woman and man, she's usually quite glamorous, he's humble, so think of Coco Mamzelle with Keira Knightley. He gets to sort of get into the bedroom with her, but before they even have sex, she's off into the night. And this advert takes it to sort of a whole new level. And it's 5 minutes long, so I won't play the whole thing unless you want me to. So what I'm going to get you to do is, when you've really had enough of it and you feel really insulted by what you're seeing, put your hand up, and then when most people have put their hand up, I'll go on to the next bit.
Thank you.
I think we still have a minority. Oh no, it's going up, but no, we're carrying on. Sorry, but we ran out of time and we'll have to see that another time. So I'm going to pass round the Shalimar now and I'll talk a bit about that ad in a sec, but let's have a smell of the fragrance. Do any of you know the perfume? Now, based on that ad, I want you to hold in your mind what could that fragrance possibly smell like? Let's forget the slight sort of racist undertones that... You know, it of course has to be a white woman in the splendour while her swarthy lover comes to find her and the humble villagers help him on his way, all of who are Asian. So let's smell it and think about what you... Did you expect it to smell of anything and does this smell as you would imagine? Who thinks this sort of works all okay enough with the advert that you just saw? A few. Who thinks this is not what they were expecting from all the pomp and ceremony? And who thinks it smells like their nan? Yeah. That's the number one comment I get in any event, is grandma's, and there's so much to be mined there. Now, the thing that I find exciting about perfume is the way that every one of us reacts to something that we smell. Fragrance marketing is quite trendy these days in that hotel chains will have a smell so that whenever you enter a Hilton, it'll smell a certain way. I'm sure many of you have seen some of the gizmos coming out of Asia, which are USB plugins and mobile phone attachments that emit a puff of fragrance when you get a text or a tweet from someone. And that's all fine, but the reason I find this a bit limiting is that we're being subjected to a smell and it's there to produce a certain effect. But what if we don't agree with that effect, or what if to us the smell is something else? And this is why I do events so that people can have fun with play. So, for example, there's a perfume here which I think is the way that they talk about it is much more interesting than the Shalimar fragrance. And this is the scent coming round now. Oh, actually, is that the right one? Hang on, I might have got the wrong one. Wait. Yeah, it's that one, sorry.
It's all right.
So there's quite a sort of kooky fragrance brand out there called Etat Libre d'Orange. And this is a scent of theirs which is called Delicious Closet Queen. And the way they talk about this fragrance is they talk about a very respectable businessman getting onto his transport in the morning. Maybe he's in a taxi. Maybe he's going off to the office in a skyscraper. But under his pinstripe suit, he's wearing ladies' underwear. And so this fragrance has been designed to be quite a conventional, sheeny, middle-of-the-road men's fragrance. But what they're trying to say is what's underneath, is what's this man really into? And the fragrance itself isn't necessarily any more interesting as a scent in terms of the combination than Shalimar, but the way that they're talking about it and inviting you to question what you're smelling is much more fun. It's much less commercial as well, but they do sell this. So what does this scent, does this say to you conventional? Do you think it's interesting?
It smells like Palmer Violet.
Palmer Violet. Aramis with an undertone of Nan. So maybe he's wearing bloomer underwear rather than a thong. He's into that look. And the thing is, when we wear a fragrance, when we walk down a street in it, no one but us knows the story behind it. So we're sold a perfume based on, well, whether it's a story or a kind of sludge of sexual attraction and mystery and a void. When we put it on, we've bought into that story, but when someone sees us in the street, they don't have that story. And so who are we wearing perfume for? Is it for us or is it for somebody else? And are we buying into a story provided to us by a marketeer, or can we start to create our own stories? And where this starts to get even more interesting is where you look at the idea of congruence. When what we smell, does that match up to our expectations about a person or a place? So, for example, one more smell coming round now. Have a sniff of this and don't say anything out loud. Don't say now. Has everyone got that? Yeah? Can everyone smell it? So if I show that with this perfume, what do you make of that combination?
I'm sold.
Huh? You're sold. So why did some of you laugh?
Because there's a dissonance.
Because there's a
dissonance. It's quite gender neutral. It's a bit, in a way it's neither here nor there, could be worn by a man or a woman, and that's the most, well, one of the most testosterone filled cliches with the Mexican boots and the bandana and the,
yeah.
You know, it's just, it doesn't work.
Yeah, so we've got a bit of a mismatch, but some of you are quite enjoying the combination, because perhaps he's suddenly a bit more, I don't know, is he a bit more interesting now? and then the other image is this one. So this is Zsa Gabor. Does this feel any more right with her than with the bloke?
Yeah.
So it's smelling as you'd expect her to smell. Now, we are always making reactions and assumptions and associations when we smell things. But usually we're not aware of them, because if we're in an environment, say a car park, we expect a car park to smell a certain way and we expect a beach to smell a certain way. And when it matches our expectations, we often, you know, it's just part of our environment. Sometimes we're in an environment that doesn't match our expectations. So for example, there's been some research done with shopping where a floral smell was put into a like a Zara type clothes shop, and people spent more money on clothes. But when they started pumping food smells into the clothes shop, people weren't sticking around because it was a bit off-putting and weird. But I think these funny juxtapositions of scent and other the other senses, whether that's visual stimuli or sound, make for fascinating exploration. The perfume that I just shared with you is by a French fragrance house called Caron, and this was originally called Royal Bain de Caron, or Royal Bain de Champagne. Oops. And this was a scent that was worn in the bath in the 1920s, and it was the sort of thing that a Hollywood starlet might have had. So it's roses and raspberries, and it's very sweet and very fruity and very feathery, that's my opinion. And so that's why, to me, if I smell this with Zaza Gabor, I feel I'm immersed in world of Zaza. When I smell it with, his moob's falling out. When I smell it with him, though, I think, bloody hell, what's going on here? This is interesting. Has he just had an affair? And he's on his way back to his trailer. And why is his hand in his boot? Is that because he doesn't have a glove? So, when it comes to fragrance, the other thing that I think is great is the way that we all have our own stories about a scent. So, I've got another one coming around. Sorry, there's only three more after this. This is a real, this is a bit of a gamble because it relies on someone recognising what this is when it comes round. And it might fail. Will you nod at me if you think you know what this is? Yes, there's a nod here. Audience participation. Any more nods? You're kind of semi-nodding. Your hand's gone straight up. So, Pete, some of the nodders, tell me about this scent.
This is that generic scent that a certain clothing company said, hey, let's just make one bottle, two people.
Are you saying generic scent because you don't believe in saying the names of brands?
No, I'm saying it's CK1.
It's CK1. And did anyone here used to wear CK1? Back in the day. You still do. Have you worn it for a long time? So since it came out? Does anyone else remember when they got their first bottle of CK1? Would you tell us?
An ex-girlfriend bought it about 12 years ago.
And how was that?
It smelled really nice. I was really pleased with it.
Lovely. Wow, we've got quite a few CK. Well, anyone else remember when you first got it? Does anyone remember the adverts?
I can't think of an advert. Honestly, I can't think
of an advert. Kate Moss. Did anyone want it but you couldn't afford it and you were jealous of your friends who had it? Yeah, do you remember which of your friends had it?
Precisely. Yeah.
Who was it? And did you go over and look at them?
Yeah, and I tried them on one of them.
Did you tell her?
Yeah.
Okay, well at least you're an honest thief. So CK1 is kind of an easy one because it's one of those generational scents that really was big at the time. And you can, often when I do events and I crack out Impulse O2, loads of women, yes, I got a gasp from somewhere. Lots of women in their 30s start nodding in shame, and we've all got the same story about netball and PE changing rooms. And, you know, that kind of female shame of having to get undressed in the changing room, and did you have a bra, or were you still in a crop top? You're remembering that. Or, for example, Lynx Africa's another one. So lots of stories around Lynx Africa, and that keeps on building. And then if you go back a generation, you might be talking a bit about Poison, women in the 80s wearing Poison, Giorgio Beverly Hills, for example, and then back and back and back. And you get these little clusters of stories when you find the people who wore them. Now, we're going to do something that takes this a step further. This is my crappily named game, Man Sequences. It's based on consequences, and I want you all, if you've got pens, can you get out a pen? This is what we're going to do. I'm going to hand out a man sequences sheet, sort of dotted around the front row, and then everyone's going to get another smell. Sorry, there's more. And if you're at the front, smell the smell and jot down an answer to the first question, which is, what's his occupation? What does he do? And then I want you to fold over the top and pass it behind you. Person behind, going to answer the next question, and so on and so forth till we get to the back. Now there are five questions, so if you will try and make sure everyone gets to answer it. So I'll just pass these along. Should we get those along the front row? And so we've got enough. So make sure you get a chance to, and then. So please don't confer and base your answers on the fragrance that's coming round now rather than the CK1. Oh, sorry about the sound. So with the first question, just to help out a bit if you're feeling a bit cold to it, with occupation, think about whether this is someone who is in a, they're sort of the type of person who'd be in a job for life. Are they in an analytical role? Are they quite creative? Are they self-employed? Are they a builder? Basically, we're going back to those, what do I want to be when they grow up? Are they a kind of Vice President Patrick Bateman style? So I'm going to start a 2-minute countdown just to speed things up a bit. I forgot to count. Shall I put the Shalimar advert on again? We're nearly there. It's just making its way back to that corner now. Has everyone done theirs? Put your hand up if you haven't done one. So are they all finished pretty much apart from one? Right, okay. What we're going to do, oh, we've got some complete ones. Okay, I'll read these ones. So, here's one. What's his occupation? A banker. What's his most treasured possession? His watch. What's he hiding? I sense an influence here. A purple man thong drawn out. How does he relax? Alone. And what's his biggest fear? Rejection. We have a lawyer with a collection of vinyl LPs who's hiding his last text, and his biggest fear is losing a case. Who did that little one? Did the person who said lawyer and the person who said losing the case know each other?
No, it's my dad's lawyer.
Ah, okay. We've got so many baths here. This is the other thing about scent. You get these subliminal influences. We have a builder with a chiseled jawline who's a tax fraud, who relaxes in a hot bath with bubbles drinking pink champagne. His biggest fear is his wife finding out anything. Any other Finnish ones? Would you like to shout them out?
We've got a hairdresser who has Fabergé eggs, who's hiding several different girlfriends, and relaxes by shooting birds, and he's worried about getting ID'd.
Any more? Yeah.
A civil servant who's a line manager. His most treasured possession is his football signed by Cristiano Ronaldo, and he's hiding an affair with the CA. He relaxes by skiing, and his biggest fear is dementia.
Contemporary issues enter. Yes.
Our guy works in the telly sales. His most treasured possession is his bracket. He's hiding a burnt nipple. He relaxes by drinking, and his biggest fear is a Labour government.
Well, with their policies on third nipples, who can blame him? This is just a series of juxtapositions, and it's quite hard doing that sort of thing with fragrance. And what's interesting about it is that you often end up going back to the sorts of social stereotypes upon which these big kind of ideas of sort of male-female identity are built, because you smell a sort of a kind of fragrance and think, okay, that must be for that sort of person. And there's no real, well, there's this potential for narrative there, but not really. We're describing features. Now, I'm not saying that fragrances do tell a story. It's very hard to tell a story with scent, as we've seen from our adverts. Do I have time for one more quick thing, or are we out of time?
Yeah, one more very quick thing.
Okay, this is what we're going to do. One more fragrance. Gaggle up into little gangs. And our final thing is crime scent investigation. Now, I did this at the Harrogate Crime Festival and it worked. We'll see if it works here. This fragrance is coming round. It's quite different from the last one. In a little group, I want you to describe a sort of criminal scenario. So I want you to decide what sort of killer would wear this perfume, who do they kill, what's their motive, what's their weapon and where do they do it, and where do they go to ground after? So be really quick, just kind of, right, what's the episode here? Don't involve anything to do with Jonathan Creek and lock room scenarios, please. And you're going to get 90 seconds to 2 minutes to decide everything, so go. Okay. Writer's huddle now ended. Can I have maybe three groups to very quickly tell their crime scene investigation outline? Any groups? Yes.
Quite some time ago, and has her buried in the back of the garden where she's waiting in the shed, covering the smell or something, decomposing, but she's keeping the body because she doesn't believe the daughter-in-law is good enough for her son. But she does make excellent fertiliser for tomatoes, so she is willing to look at the produce there.
Any more? Yep.
An ageing Scandinavian drag queen killed her young ladyboy usurper in the back of the cinema showing David Lynch America, where the body was left to rot during the end of Twin Peaks.
Oh. Yeah.
This is the smell of Midsummer Murders. This is the 40-something respectable chair of the Horticultural Society who's bumping off the villagers with her poisoned cupcakes.
Yeah, very good. One more.
We've got somebody with a bit of an odour problem. They've gone for a very stereotypical granny smell, and dressed as a granny whilst they continue to lure someone in there. And she has
a So, a delightful tale, a set of terrible tales involving knitting needles. Aged drag queens and tomato fertiliser. So I will finish now because I think I'm running over a bit. So what I suppose I was hoping to convey with smell is it's often seen as very intimidating as a design language or something to incorporate into work. But it's seen as quite nebulous, and how do you pin down what somebody thinks? But what I was hoping to share today is actually the ambiguity of fragrance, the fact that it's personal, but the fact that we do make these snap judgments, these assumptions that we're not even aware of until we have fun with it, actually can create some really fun, hopefully you've had fun, some fun experiences and moments, and actually forget the Shalimar advert and writhing around in a bed and suggesting that she's masturbating without being able to show it. And that was too much for this time of day. And actually, let's remember that fragrance is there for us to enjoy rather than to sort of revere and venerate but be slightly put off by. So thanks very much, everyone. I'm on Twitter as Odette Toilette, and I do lots of different events if you want to come to any. It's odettetoilette.com. Thank you.